you've already stated your name, why don't you state your name for the record? Just in case I made a mistake.
It's still Mr. Hutchins. A.J. Hutchins for the appellant, Stephen Jaffe. Thank you, Your Honor. So, clearly established federal law forbids the state from introducing the prior testimony of a witness unless the defendant has had an adequate opportunity effectively to cross-examine that witness. Stephen Jaffe, the appellant in this case, was convicted of the most serious of the crimes charged against him on the basis of the testimony of one Officer Miller, who was never cross-examined at all. There was certainly ample material for a devastating cross-examination of Officer Miller, because at the time he testified at the preliminary hearing, he was under federal investigation for extortion, human trafficking, racketeering, money laundering, and conspiracy.
Did he know he was under investigation at the time of the preliminary hearing?
No, I don't believe he did. I assume that if he had known that, he would have taken the Fifth Amendment then and would have refused to testify. The state withheld those facts from him, but more importantly for our purposes, the state withheld those facts from the defense in this case to assert that the defense had an adequate opportunity to effectively cross-examine the key witness in this case is objectively unreasonable. Davis versus Alaska, Delaware versus Von Arsdal established that at a very minimum, an adequate opportunity to cross-examine includes the opportunity to question the witness about prototypical forms of impeachment. And I would submit...
But those cases focus on reasons that you might have a motive to lie in those particular cases, though, that the witness might have had a motive to lie. What is your theory about the motive here? You may have general information that this guy is dishonest, but why would he have had a motive to plant evidence in this case?
Thank you, Your Honor. It was brought out and it was argued in the trial court. If you have a dirty cop who's trying to cover his tracks, one of the best ways of doing that is to appear to be the best cop possible.
So, he didn't know he was under investigation, so why would he have had that motive at this point?
Well, because he certainly knew he was dirty. He had been engaging in all kinds of illegal activities, so he certainly had a motivation to present the appearance of being a super cop. So he would have had a motivation to turn a case of gun possession into a drug and gun possession case, which multiplies the penalties. That would be a motivation. But beyond that, besides the motivation to lie, there's just simple impeachment. There is the well-established rule that crimes of moral turpitude tend to impeach a witness and destroy the witness's credibility. And
we need to have clearly established law for the proposition that you have that right to cross-examine, even when the impeachment evidence doesn't directly go to bias. I mean, you're making a bias. You're making an argument about what the motive would be, but it's pretty thin, I think, given that he didn't know he was under investigation, and that this is a pretty small crime. So it's already a drug crime. The guy admits he has the cocaine. So what this officer adds is not exactly heroic in the big scheme of things, I don't think. So this motive, it makes me worry that you don't have clearly established law on point. The motive in the cases that do exist, much clearer that people were trying to save their own criminal history directly related to the case in question.
Well, Judge Friedland, 2 points in that regard. They didn't have the drug. Without Officer Miller, they didn't have a drug case. They did not have a drug case. As the defendant said quite cogently to the trial court.
Well, but in the hospital, he says, did you find the cocaine in the pocket? So he introduces the drug evidence himself. I mean, there is drug evidence that comes from the defendant himself.
Yes, but there's no way that they could have gotten a conviction of him having cocaine in his pocket if they couldn't produce the cocaine. I mean, imagine the defense argument at trial. They say he possessed cocaine. Well, they've had his car, all of his possessions. They've had the defendant himself in custody. It's their burden to prove that he possessed cocaine. Where is the cocaine?
He told them where to find the cocaine
was no cocaine to present to the jury without Officer Miller's testimony.
But what is your support for that? Because my understanding was that he could have been kept out, so then there would have been a break in the chain. But I thought that went to the persuasiveness of the evidence and not its admissibility.
Absolutely not. That may be true under federal law. That is absolutely not the case under California law. People versus Reiser holds that if any vital link in the chain of possession is not accounted for, the evidence must be excluded because it is as likely as not that the evidence that was analyzed was not the evidence originally received.
I'm not concerned about your chain of custody argument, but I am concerned about the argument that this case seems to be really different factually from a lot of them, where the jury really doesn't have any reason to suspect that there's a problem with the witness's testimony. And that's not the case here, right?
I'm sorry, Judge Kristen. I'm not sure that I followed you.
Well, the jury did have some indication about the situation, right?
About what was wrong with Miller. They had some indication.
That distinguishes this case, it seems to me. They got this very fuzzy instruction stipulation. I'm sure they would have had questions about it because it was pretty vague, right?
Respectfully, Your Honor, it absolutely does not distinguish this case. What Crawford versus Washington requires is cross-examination. Without cross-examination, none of Miller's evidence could come in. Stipulation wouldn't matter. You can't get there by introducing other evidence. Crawford is absolutely clear about this.
Do you think this case isn't distinguishable from other cases where there isn't any reason to doubt the witness's credibility? Is that your argument?
Yes, it is. It is my argument because the point isn't whether they are going to doubt the witness's credibility. There would not have been the witness. His testimony would not have come.
Let's go back to this. To me, this break in custody is actually very important because you're saying this drugs wouldn't have come in at all, and I guess I'm still not persuaded that we should be looking at it the way it seems like you are. So maybe you can help me. So I'm not sure I read the California law the same way, but let me give you the California law. Is that why are we bound by that on federal habeas? Because do you have authority for the idea that the question we're supposed to ask is whether the evidence would have come in under California evidence law rather than whether it would have been a due process violation or some other constitutional federal issue for the evidence to come in at that point? Because I think it's clear this evidence could have come in under federal law. And so why should I be looking at the California evidence rules to answer this question?
There are two steps. The first step is that none of Miller's statements could have come in.
I agree with you.
That is federal.
Yeah. So why does that mean the drugs don't come in? This is where I'm stuck.
Because without Miller's statements, then under state law, they would be excluded.
So what in federal habeas tells me to look at state law for that question?
What federal habeas tells you, what Coy versus Iowa tells you, what this court's decision in Nguyen and other cases tells you, is that in evaluating the error, what you have to do is completely take out the testimony.
Right, but I completely take out the testimony.
So the question is but for what would have happened? What would have happened if none of Miller's statements could have come in? If none of Miller's statements could have come in as a matter of law binding on the court that was hearing the case, the drug evidence couldn't have come in.
But I mean, so how do we know that the state court wouldn't have come up with some sort of residual exception or something? I mean, as a matter of state law, the state would make some determination. Aren't we on federal habeas supposed to figure out, like, was a constitutional right violated by what would have happened in the alternative universe? And it seems like under federal law, the drug evidence could have come in. So I'm just a little confused about this.
Well, because you know, this reminds me much of the case that Judge Fletcher decided from the en banc court involving Batson error. And the name will come to me shortly. But where this court held, yes, there would have been error under Batson. But at that point, what was applicable was state law. And so we can't find error because the question is, what would the state court have done? In this case, the question is, absent Miller's testimony, what would the state court have done? And state law is absolutely clear. It's, as far as I know, as far as the paper with the brief show, absolutely undisputed that the chain of custody requirement would have required the exclusion of evidence absent Miller's testimony.
Okay, why don't we hear from the other side? You used your time, but we'll make sure you get a chance to respond.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Morning. May it please the Court, and Kramer out for responding. On the subject of Crawford,
Could you start with this chain of custody thing? Because it's really very important to me, and I'm confused about it. Do you agree that California wouldn't have allowed in the drug evidence if Miller couldn't have testified here?
No, for a couple of reasons. One is, and I'm not quite sure this hasn't come up, this was resolved, and that resolution, that hearing didn't involve Miller's testimony.
But I think the court made an error about these written records. I think that included Miller's testimony. So let's assume the written records are out. Everything that Miller said is out. Now would the drugs have come in under California law, or is the question whether they would come in under California law?
Frankly, I haven't researched California law. I know that there is a chain of custody rule, but what would have happened in the absence, I don't know whether the prosecution could have come up with something else that we don't know about or whether there was some other exception. I don't believe that's before this court. The chain of custody is a question of state law, and it was resolved.
But if we think they made an error about the chain of custody because some of it is confrontation clause violation in the sense that Miller's testimony itself would come out, Miller's written testimony also comes out under the confrontation clause, if we think that, then where are you in terms of this question of whether the drugs would come in?
I don't know whether under California law, and I don't, and I think that's one of the problems with it not having been raised before, is at the hearing itself, there was no dispute about the reports and the property labels. So those were relied upon, and if those hadn't been there, I don't know, and we don't know what else could have been produced. That's part of the reason why I believe that should be a conclusive finding. This has never been challenged.
Did Officer Cassell's testimony overlap?
Officer Cassell's testimony overlapped in a few different ways. Not entirely, but in a few different ways. In terms of at the scene where they're at the car, identified the, Officer DeBobia.
Well, I guess I have a follow-up question, and maybe it goes to, and this might help jog your memory, but there was an inconsistency between the accounts of where the officers were when the evidence was found, right?
Yes.
Okay. And was the jury aware of that inconsistency about whether they're back in the lab or out in the field?
I believe they were.
All right, so can you back to my other question about to what extent does Officer Cassell's testimony fill this gap? And I think maybe you answered it in part because you said it overlapped, but not complete overlap.
Well, in part, Officer Cassell testified that in the property room he saw, now this is the inconsistency, but it's still corroborating, I believe he saw Detective Miller, Officer Miller, pull the wallet out and inventory the contents and make the comment about what do we have here. And then run a presumptive test, and he witnessed all that. This wasn't told to him, and then the results of that presumptive test also were corroborated by the criminalist.
But the inconsistency is where that happened, I think.
Yes,
yeah.
Where the presumptive test happened.
Or they might argue whether it's the right wallet.
Well, Detective DeBobian identified the wallet as the same wallet that she looked at, and I think Cassell did too. At trial, she identified that as the wallet that she looked at and that they handed around at the scene of the car. She also identified some of the contents. There was a check cashing card or something like that with some identification on it. And she identified that, and so did Officer Cassell.
So your argument is you get these drugs out of this wallet without Miller at all, and so this whole Miller thing doesn't matter.
Yes. Officer DeBobian also, at one point, remarks that she saw that the last time she saw it or the first time she saw it was when he pulled it out of the pants pocket. So now that nobody, of course, is testifying what happened between the scene and when it was inventoried, but go get the drugs. I don't know whether he said go get the cocaine, but he was told go get the drugs. So I don't see what planting is going to get him on that subject. And the planting of methamphetamine under all the circumstances was a very weak addition. Going back to the cocaine, of course you have the metabolites in the bloodstream, which were very corroborative.
Do you have a response to their argument that what we look at is state law for this chain of custody issue? Do you agree with that in terms of how we look at what would have happened in the alternative universe, or are we looking at federal law for whether it would have been a violation for the drugs to come in if there were a break in the chain of custody?
Well, I believe it's state law, and that's the reason I believe it should be conclusive. It's never been challenged. We've been through 3 rounds of state court review, 2 rounds of federal review. It has never been raised until now, and that's
something. You may be right. I'm just looking back at the briefs. Did he not raise this till his reply brief here?
No, opening brief.
Opening brief here. So did you argue in your answering brief that it had never been raised before?
Yes.
Okay.
I said for the first time, Jaffe raises the chain of custody. And the reports, going back, I understand your, I think I can glean your position on the reports, but nevertheless, just going back to that, maybe this could have been resolved differently. The courts have relied on those reports. Those have never been challenged, and those are distinct pieces of evidence that were created at different times for different purposes. But the district court relied on that, mentioned it, was discussed in argument at the trial. There has never been a claim, and I believe that is, because there's never been a claim, that those are fair game in the mix of harmless error analysis. The court has no further questions. I would submit it.
Okay, I think we don't.
Thank you.
Thank you. Let's put a minute on the clock for response.
Counsel, could you address this? I think we understand your chain of custody argument, but why is it fairly before us?
I very much
disagree. Okay.
It's true that I did not use the words chain of custody in the California Supreme Court. It had been argued as chain of custody before that in the trial court. It was a chain of custody motion. And the argument that was made then is the same argument.
Any citations to the record, counsel? That's what we're looking for.
Rather than take the time now, may I submit those? Yes, I do, and I have it right here if you'd like me to take the time.
Don't let me interrupt you. Go ahead. We can circle back.
I'd be glad to read you the argument that I submitted to the California Supreme Court, which was, quote, it was Miller who claimed to find the bindles in petitioner's wallet, Miller who did the presumptive test and announced what he found in those bindles was methamphetamine, and Miller who booked into evidence the bindles he found and the powder he claimed to find within them. In short, without Miller's testimony, there was no admissible evidence the petitioner possessed methamphetamine. Similarly, it was Miller alone who found the cocaine in petitioner's jacket, and without his testimony, there was no legally sufficient proof the petitioner possessed cocaine. That is a chain of custody argument.
So the thing that I think gets added, though, and my recollection was that it wasn't really explicit until your reply brief, but I could be remembering that wrong, is that Miller's testimony is also on the property labels, because it seems like the state court thought the property labels filled this gap, but I think your argument is no, these property labels are also Miller's testimony.
Well, the property labels actually, let me back up. The property labels were challenged in the state court along with Miller's testimony. The argument there was there's been no cross-examination as to them. This is, quote, a backdoor way of getting in Miller's testimony.
But the state court rejected that, right?
Because it didn't find a confrontation clause error with regard to Miller at all.
And so, if we disagree,
yes.
Your argument now is both things stay.
Yes, it's a but-for test. But for the error in admitting Miller in denying, but for the confrontation error, neither would have come in. If the state court had apprehended co-
Crawford versus Washington, which it clearly did not. It couldn't have admitted either of those.
Let me ask this practical question, which I think is not really addressed to the merits at all. This is habeas. He's now out of custody.
He is.
He's on some form of supervised release.
He has finished his supervised release. The federal courts have had the case for 10 years, and he's done his time.
He's done his time. Okay.
Yeah.
So should we care then about what we're now arguing about?
Well, that's a legal matter and a practical matter, and the answer is as to both yes. I mean, having a drug plus gun violation on his record is far more serious. As a matter of habeas law, the fact that the habeas was filed when he was in custody is all that's required. I'd very quickly like to respond to a couple of other points that my colleague made. The thing with Cassell or DeBogien, seeing the wallet, okay, they saw the wallet at the scene. They saw the wallet 2 hours later. They didn't see the wallet with methamphetamine in it until 2 hours later when Miller said, oh, here's methamphetamine. Look what we have here, is what he said.
You're over time, so you can make your points, but please do so quickly.
Okay. So the point being, that is a classic chain of custody problem. The question is, what happened in those 2 hours? Only Miller can address that. What happened when he took the cocaine out of the car? Only Miller can address that. The motive regarding cocaine, I disagree strongly. If, as happened, Miller's told, there's cocaine in the jacket, and he's trying to make himself a better cop, he puts cocaine in the jacket. It doesn't disprove it. In fact, it reinforces that scenario. Finally, I would like to address the first question that I was asked by Judge Friedland about whether clearly established federal law requires an opportunity to cross-examine regarding prior criminal acts. I think I am content with my motive argument, but nonetheless, what the cases say, the general rule is prototypical forms of impeachment, and the case law has not been confined to bias.
Is this an argument as to whether there's a confrontation clause violation at all?
No, this is an argument as to whether there is a clearly established federal law in support of my. The case law is not confined to cases involving bias. There are cases that I cited where, there is contradictory.
We got the point.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
The case is submitted. Thank you, Your Honor.
Jaffe versus Kramer submitted for decision. Thank both sides for your arguments. And the last argued case this morning is Hamer versus City of Eureka.